An aspect of Native identity that isn't always fully appreciated is that it is primarily, and perhaps most importantly, a political identity. That Native people are of sovereign indigenous nations, and that comes with an entire body of federal Indian law. So questions of tribal enrollment, of land use, resource use, the question of who can and can't be adopted by whom and how. There are a myriad of laws that are idiosyncratic that in many ways govern our existence. Perhaps for that reason, when we saw the first wave of Native people and second, I believe we're probably on the third now, going to college, many of them went on to law school because that would give them more power and influence in self-determination and protecting their nations and citizens and working toward reclamation of what they may have lost, not only in terms of land, but a myriad of rights. So you often see that reflected in the pages of Native created books and short stories for young readers. There are a number of us who are both recovering, you might say, lawyers, as well as tribal members and children's authors. My dear friends, Tracy Sorrell, who's Cherokee, and Kevin Noble Malliard, who is Seminole, are also lawyers. And you get us together on a panel. And one of the things we're most interested in is how the question of sovereignty, for example, is really delineated. I think that there is a tendency to think of us purely in terms of being another ethnic or racial group, when really there is a larger political framework to it. You know, we vote for tribal officials, for example, and those parts of our daily life haven't really been seen on the page until we've had a kind of watershed moment in the creative Native children's YA literary scene. To have members of those communities showing what it means to be specifically Muscogee, specifically Cherokee, specifically Seminole, Navajo, whatever nation it might be, makes a big difference on how that is framed to both Native and non-Native young readers.